गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक. द लास्ट वीडियो वॉज फ्रॉम द लेसन, द सिंगिंग लेसन, इन विच वी हैड रीच पेज नंबर 93. द लास्ट पैराग्राफ आई थिंक यू ऑल हैव मार्क्ड इट, पेज नंबर 93. आई विल जस्ट फ्लैश बैक एंड आई विल रीड अ फ्यू लाइन्स बिफोर. सो वी वर ऑन दिस पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट. I feel more and more strongly that our marriage would be a mistake. She beat, and the voice cried, Preeti, ah, Preeti, what could have possessed him to write such a letter? So we were on the point where the singing lesson was on. The girls were asked to take out a lamenting song to perform it because the teacher was in a sad and depressed state of mind. And while the girls were performing, the teacher's mind was on her fiancé's letter, in which the wordings were being repeated in her mind. The wordings were, what could have, like the wordings were, I feel more and more strongly that our marriage would be a mistake. The wordings were that he had said to her that now he is realizing the fact that if they got married, it would be a mistake. She is trying to fathom out, she is trying to think, how could he have said such a statement? What could be the reason behind him writing such a line? Anyway, now we continue. What could have led up to it? As I said, she is contemplating in her mind, what could be the exact reason why he wrote such a line? It came out of nothing. It came out of nothing, meaning that she was least expecting her fiancé to write such a letter. His last letter had been all about a fumed oak bookcase he had brought for our books, and she is recollecting a previous letter that he had written, in which he has written and told her that he has gone ahead, purchased some furniture for their new house, in which he has also mentioned a beautiful, beautiful bookstand they have, yeah, he has purchased to put in their new house after they were married. And just after that letter, immediately after that letter, here she has got the letter in which he is calling off the marriage. So it was really a bolt from the blue, such a letter, thinking what could be the exact cause of him writing such a letter. A natty little hall, and he had seen a very neat affair with a carved owl on a bracket, holding three hat brushes in its claws. Again, he has also written to her that he has seen a beautiful hat stand. Out there, there were hats. So on the door, the stand is placed, in which when you enter a home, you take off your hat and you put it on that stand there. So he has gone and seen such beautiful type of furniture for their to-be house. How she has smiled at that. And when he wrote such letters to her, and when she realized that he is working on their future life, planning for their future home, it used to bring her joy, happiness, and she would smile within herself, thinking that her to-be husband is getting all these things ready for their new home. So like a man, to think one needed three hat brush. From the listening ear sang the voices. Once again, said Mrs. Meadow. Now the class was on. She was not least concentrating on the class, and the children were singing. When the song started, when the song ended, she did not know anything. When she realized that the children are not singing, she is telling them or giving him instructions to repeat that song and once again go ahead with the singing of that song. Fast, ah, too fast, with the gloom of the control added, one could scarcely help shuddering. And she is telling the children that the effect of that gloomy feelings in the song is not coming. They should sing it in such a way where they bring out their feelings of gloom, which she is wanting them to do. Fade the roses of pleasure. Again, these are the wording of the song. Fade the roses of pleasure. Last time he had come to see her. Now she is on both sides. She is telling the children how to express their feelings in the song. At the same time, she is recollecting his letter. And there she is telling herself, last time he had come to see her, Basil had worn a rose in his buttonhole. When you have a coat, there's a buttonhole here. So the last time he had come to meet her, she can still remember that he had this particular rose placed in his buttonhole. How handsome he had looked in that bright blue suit with that dark red rose. And she is picturizing him having that beautiful blue suit on with a beautiful rose put into the buttonhole. And he knew it too. He couldn't help knowing it. First he stroked his hair, then his mustache, his teeth gleamed when he smiled. And he knew that he was looking smart that day. And he knew that Miss Meadows, on looking at him, on seeing him, felt the same, that he is extremely smart and handsome. And within his mind, he just smiled at her to comfort her. The headmaster's wife keeps on asking me to dinner. It's a perfect nuisance. I never get an evening to myself in that place. See, the headmaster's wife keeps on asking me to dinner. Okay? So here he is written on and told Basil, has told this lady that the headmaster's wife has repeatedly asked him to come over, to make her jealous, to come for dinner. It's a perfect nuisance. I never get an evening to myself in that place. But can't you refuse? So she's telling the conversation, and when he tells her that a lady has invited him for dinner, she's telling him that you can also politely refuse the offer also. There's no need for you to accept it. Oh well, it doesn't do for a man in my position to be unpopular. So he tells her that, you know, she's the headmaster's wife, and if I refuse her invitation, it could have some effect on my career, on me also. So for a man like me, it's not proper to go and refuse such an order. So every time I'm asked, I very reluctantly accept the offer also. Music, gay measure, wailed the voices, that is, cried the girl. The lesson was on, the song was on. The willow trees outside the high narrow windows waved in the wind. There, the author now is describing this, the full setting, that outside the class there was a breeze on, the oaks, the willows were growing outside there, and those sounds could be heard. They had lost half their leaves. They are the trees that are growing outside in the compound of the school. The tiny ones, that all the trees, the tiny ones had clung, wriggled like fishes caught on a line. The small, small leaves were still on the branches stuck, but the bigger leaves, being autumn, had fallen off. I am not a marrying man. Now she's looking out, trying to calm herself down, trying to concentrate on her girls, giving him the proper lesson, but nothing of that sort is happening. Again, a line from the letter she recollects. I am not a marrying man, in which he had told her that he is not the man for a marriage, that sometimes men believe that they are not the marrying type, that they are not in a position to get married, to settle down, to have a family, to take control of the family, to take responsibility of family. Some men are happy-go-lucky, they can't do all these things. So I'm not a marrying man. The voices were silent. The piano waited. Again, the song finished. She was lost in her thoughts. The children had finished the song, stopped the singing. Piano was not being played by Mary, but Ma'am Meadows was lost in her own world. Quite good, said Miss Meadows. Now she had not even heard the song, and she is complimenting the girls that this time you'll have played the music well and the song is quite good. But still, in such a strange stormy tone that the younger girls began to feel positively frightened. But the way she was conducting herself, the way she was speaking, the way she was interacting with the girls, in their small minds, they also knew that something was wrong, and they were getting frightened of this teacher today, the way she is behaving, the strange behavior that she is showing. But now that we know it, we shall take it with expression. Now she tells the girl that now, since you all have learned the song, picked up the wordings, we will take it with expression, meaning redo that song with expressions now. as much expression as you can put into it. And she tells them that they can put on whatever expression they can, and whatever, whichever way they want to express their feelings, by a smile or whatever way, they are free to do it. But the song should have expressions now. Think of the words. And then she's telling them, guiding them, think of the words, girl. Use your imagination. She's telling them, see the wordings, how they go. Use your individual imagination and put on your expressions. Fast, oh fast, cried Miss Meadows. She's telling them the words of that song. That ought to break out. Meaning she's telling them that this line in the song should stand out. And when it is heard, it should have that clarity in it, perfection in it. That ought to break out a loud, strong forte. It's telling this line should be sung in a loud tone, a lament, and it should have the feeling of a lament in it also. And then in the second line, winter dear my, that dearer sound as if a cold wind were blowing through. And says when the word dearer winter comes, your feelings of winter, feelings of cold, of uneasiness, should be shown in that line. Dearer, she's even telling them how to prolong the word dearer, said she in an awfully, that Mary Beasley on the music stool wriggled her spine. And she was conducting herself so unnaturally that even Mary, her pet, her most favorite student, felt something was wrong. And she was very uncomfortable sitting on that stool because she was the nearest to the teacher, and very, very uncomfortable she was. The third line should be one crescendo. Crescendo is the beat, the tone of the song. Fleety, ah, fleety, music, gay, measure. This is the third line of, and she's telling them, guiding them, what type of expressions should be put into it. Then on the word away, and said, emphasize on the word away. You must begin to die, to fade until the listening ear is nothing more than a faint whisper. And says the song should just fade away as if one is whispering. When you're whispering, it's very soft. So that emotion should be soft and delicate while they are going and singing this particular line. You can slow down as much as you like, almost on the last line now, please. She tells them that if they want, they can even slow down the tone of that song. Take their own tone, slow it down. It was all their choice. And she's giving them the freedom to do whatever they want with the tone of the song. But she wanted that feeling should come out in every line. So my dear student, we will do till this line, page number 94. But before I end, I would also like to tell you all, remind you all that we have a few more pages left. And after every chapter, like other subjects also, I will also be taking a test, right? So when this chapter ends, when it's finished, when the last video is on, along with the video, I will send you all a message in which you all will be told about the test. So every lesson, we are taking these tests so that we want that you all should cooperate with us. The way we are trying to teach you all, we want that you all follow our instructions, because this is the best that we can do for you all, right? Explaining it from here, unlike a class, we are doing it, no doubt. But if you all cooperate, if you all are really hard working, you all will also prepare yourself. We will eventually come back to school, come back to class, and then all your problems, all the things we will discuss, any other problem that we have, everything will be sorted out. But do as your teachers tell you. So my dear students, I think that's enough for the day. Goodbye, good bless.